In more than 200 countries around the world, PepsiCo products are consumed more than 1 billion times daily. The mammoth company also generates over $70 billion in net revenue annually. But it had to overcome numerous bankruptcies before that could happen. We must go all the way back to 1889 in order to comprehend how Pepsi Company was created. Caleb Bradham, a pharmacist, first invented Pepsi-Cola at that time. Caleb ran his own soda fountain inside his drugstore, just like many other pharmacists at the time. His signature libation was a concoction he dubbed Brad's Drink. Sugar, water, caramel, lemon oil, cola nuts, nutmeg, and other flavorings were all combined in it. And it was the ideal item to revive and energize his clients. He made the decision to change the drink's name as it gained popularity in an effort to rival Coca-Cola's fame. Like the original cola, he gave it the name Pepsi-Cola. The beverage was flavorful, sweet, and carbonated, and it eventually gained such a following that Caleb established his own business in 1902. At first, he referred to it as the Pepsi-Cola Company. The words exhilarating, invigorating aids, digestion, which may not be the most alluring slogan, were used to market Pepsi as a digestive aid. But it appears that Pepsi-Cola also took notice of that. As the brand gained popularity, they changed strategies, got rid of the slogan, and started relying more on the influence of celebrities to boost sales. As a spokesperson, Barney Oldfield was hired. The era's most well-known race car driver, Barney, quickly rose to fame thanks to his catchphrase, "Drink Pepsi, it will satisfy you." The advertising campaign was a huge success, and Pepsi-Cola would continue to use famous people for decades to come, but then tragedy struck. After experiencing years of prosperity, the business struggled following World War I. Caleb had bet on the fluctuations in sugar prices during the war, and anticipating further price increases, he purchased massive quantities of sugar. But sadly for him, the complete opposite occurred. As a result, Caleb was left with an expensive stock of sugar. He failed, and Pepsi-Cola filed for bankruptcy. Now what? Coca-Cola had long since supplanted Pepsi-Cola as the leading brand by the time Pepsi-Cola filed for bankruptcy. It was being sold all over the United States and in many other nations, and the future for small Pepsi could not have looked worse. The company's trademark, patents, and other assets were purchased by a group of creditors for only $30,000, and a few months later Roy Marger acquired full ownership of Pepsi when he paid them off for $35,000. Roy did his part to keep the business going by personally lending it money and relocating the plant and offices to Richmond, Virginia. But when the Great Depression struck, despite his valiant efforts, he was unable to keep the business solvent. Additionally, Pepsi-Cola was declared bankrupt in 1931. Charles Guth entered the fray that same year with plans to found a brand new, prosperous Pepsi-Cola company. He started working right away and not only hired a chemist to create a better beverage, but also established new bottling facilities. In order to compete with Pepsi, which was essentially offering twice as much as Coke in its 6-ounce bottles, he started selling 12-ounce bottles for just 5 cents. It started making claims that it was twice as much for a nickel. It soon became the first nickel and dime radio jingle to be broadcast coast to coast, and it scored an unexpected hit. The song would eventually be released in 55 different languages, and it was even hailed as one of the most successful commercials of the 20th century. However, the profit margin was also an issue. Charles understood that for the business to thrive, it would need to expand. So, he constructed bottling facilities across the nation and today signed up hundreds of bottlers. For the following 20 years, this would be referred to as scaling. As Pepsi-Cola continued to grow, Alfred Steele was appointed as its CEO. In 1950, it exponentially expanded. Alfred, a former vice president of Coca-Cola, understood the importance of advertising. As a result of his emphasis on massive advertising campaigns and sales promotions, Pepsi-Cola's net earnings increased by an astounding 11 times. Cola still outsold Pepsi more than 5 to 1, despite Pepsi becoming the primary rival of Cola. In any case, Pepsi believed they knew exactly how to accomplish that. Coke was probably the drink of choice for older people if it was the original, authentic version. Pepsi's response was to target the then young baby boomers and change its emphasis to the younger generation under the slogan Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. The early 1960s saw the beginning of this shift in marketing, and it didn't take long for it to take off. Pepsi halved Coke's lead in just a few years. The Pepsi brand was expanding quickly, and in order to keep up, it continued to change in various ways. With the introduction of its first diet soda in 1964, Pepsi became the first national cola to provide consumers with a calorie-free option. In addition to purchasing the well-known Mountain Dew brand in the same year, Diet Pepsi was specifically marketed toward young consumers. Pepsi and snack manufacturer Frito-Lay co-emerged not even a year later, leading to the creation of PepsiCo after realizing the need to continue diversifying. Immediately after its creation, PepsiCo set out to accomplish that. Additionally, it acquired Pizza Hut, Taco Bell, KFC, and 7-Up International between 1977 and 1986. Naturally, it continued to concentrate on its Pepsi brand as well. As a result, the once-failing Pepsi was now in danger of dethroning Coca-Cola as the leading soda brand in the US. The brand additionally garnered international attention in 1974 when it became the first US product to be manufactured and marketed inside the USSR. But is this sufficient? Even though Pepsi continued to expand its market share in the 1970s and early 1980s, Coca-Cola was still the world's most popular soft drink. Younger drinkers were drawn to their Pepsi generation advertisements. While the aggressive Pepsi Challenge campaign now targeted older consumers, consumers participated in the campaign by completing blind taste tests, and they frequently discovered they preferred Pepsi's sweeter flavor over Coca-Cola's, and Coca-Cola's Atlanta headquarters shook with fear and worse as a result. Did their own research confirm Pepsi's assertion? Again, Pepsi was unstoppable, and in 1984, it made history by selecting Michael Jackson as its spokesperson at the time. During this time, MJ was enjoying success with his Thrillers, and Pepsi hired many other well-known people throughout the decade, including Tina Turner, Joe Montana, and Michael J. Fox. But Pepsi really made marketing history with MJ. There were basically two types of people in the 1980s, Coca-Cola drinkers and Pepsi drinkers. And if you were a fan of Michael Jackson, you had another good reason to want to join the Pepsi family. Coca-Cola had previously made him a $1 million deal, but he turned it down. The Jacksons then switched to PepsiCo. Roger Enrico, the CEO of PepsiCo, was seeking a game-changing concept at the time. Who would be better for that purpose than the king of pop to make Pepsi look young and Coke look old? They made a $5 million deal that not only broke the previous record for celebrity endorsement deals but also bonded the two businesses for 10 years. In 1985, the Coca-Cola duopoly was at war, and Pepsi started to outsell Coke in supermarkets. Between the late 1970s and the early 1990s, PepsiCo had to focus on other aspects of its business while the battle between cola and Pepsi raged on. By acquiring companies outside of its primary focus of packaged food and beverage brands, it had continued to grow. However, it became obvious by 1997 that these numerous non-core businesses were not as profitable as they had hoped. Despite accounting for 36% of its portfolio, restaurants only contributed about 22% of its $3.7 billion profit. Realizing that it would be better to stick to soda and Frito-Lay snacks, the previously acquired fast food outlets were spun off into a new, independent company called Tricon Global Restaurants, which later changed its name to Yum Brands as part of another exit strategy. After getting rid of the fast food chains, a new era of mergers and acquisitions started, and it appeared that PepsiCo wanted to go a different direction this time, looking to add more products that appeared to be healthy. In 1998, it purchased the Tropicana and Dole Juice brands from Seagram, and in 2001, it merged with the Quaker Oats business to create a new division called Quaker Foods and Beverages. PepsiCo has started concentrating more on growing its operations outside of the US after experiencing enormous success there. By the early 2000s, Russia was already its second largest market. PepsiCo eventually became the biggest food and beverage company in the entire country after purchasing a controlling stake in Russia's largest juice manufacturer in 2008 and concluding its acquisition of Wim & Dan Foods 3 years later. PepsiCo is one of the most popular brands in the world right now. Its product line includes a variety of foods and beverages, including 23 brands with annual sales of more than $1 billion. Like its competitors, the company's success is fueled by a diverse portfolio of food and drinks, which includes Frito-Lay Gatorade, Pepsi-Cola Mountain, Dew, Quaker, Tropicana, and SodaStream, to name a few. The Pepsi brand has expanded in ways that Caleb Braham could never have imagined. Currently, Pepsi-Cola's memorable commercials are almost as well known as its ongoing conflict with its enduring rival. It has become one of the most recognizable products in the world since its introduction in 1898. Did you already know that it had been bankrupt multiple times? What additional information do you believe could have been included in this story? Share it in the comments and be sure to watch more motivational business videos on our channel.